The story of ECG in the Ashanti region, but President John Dramani Mahama has created a new ministry of power. He has thus nominated MP for Pru East and chairman of the Parliamentary Committee on Energy, Dr. Kwabena Donkor, to head it. The establishment of the ministry forms part of a restructuring of the power sector to ensure more stability and security of power. A statement from the office of the president and signed by the chief of staff, Prosper Bani, said the president expects the new ministry to bring about a sharper focus on the generation, supply and efficiency of power to match the growth the economy is experiencing. Power producers and distributors, namely Volta River Authority, VRA, Ghana Grid Company Gridco and the Electricity Company of Ghana ECG, have been struggling to meet the generation targets needed for industries, business and homes. The water level in the Akonsombo Dam, which serves as Ghana's biggest plant with an installed capacity of 1,020 megawatts, has also been reducing steadily. It currently produces only 775 megawatts. This led to the release by the ECG of a load shedding timetable. But there have been complaints from the public about inconsistencies in the power outage schedules. Right, so we have David Agbe. He is the executive director, Ghana Institute of Governance and Security, and he has arrived in Accra from Kumasi. He did just last Sunday. Last night. We'll be finding out from him how his trip was went for him, and then we'll also explore a few areas in the energy sector. David, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you.
How was your trip?
It's nice and good, you know. We hope that things will stabilize with regards to the erratic power supply in the country.
The energy crisis has persisted for years now in the country, and it seems we cannot get over it. Will you also attribute it to lack of planning?
Yes, obviously. It's lack of, you know, strategic planning by the successors, you know, government. You know, if you looked at the history of this country right from Kwame Nkrumah up to date, it's only Kwame Nkrumah who has been able to, you know, build the Akonsombo Dam, and quite recently we have these Bui Dam and other, you know, smaller units which generate, you know, power. So it tells you clearly that our leaders are not strategic enough of predicting unforeseen circumstances. So it's like they are comfortable in their own zone, not thinking, you know, beyond future, you know, average human level. And so these are the situation that has necessitated all these kind of, you know, crisis in the country, and it's not good at all. We believe that our leaders should have been sharp enough by reasoning beyond what an average person could do, but they are not doing that. So it tells you that our voting pattern in the country, we need to re-examine the kind of people that need to be, you know, selected or that need to be elected to govern this country. Because it looks as if that we just join political parties and just impose somebody on us, and those people do not have what it takes to be able to govern the country properly. So we have a deficit of you know, knowledge in the country.
But do you think a bipartisan democracy would play a good role in this case?
As you speak now, you see, Africa, we have a serious problem. We've just jumped onto democracy without knowing a certain repercussion. You know, recently, one of the countries, when people were agitating for democracy, one man just wrote, "Democracy is good, but it's very expensive." That is what he wrote. Democracy is a rudiment where you need to pass through a certain processes before you'll be able to see its maturity. And Ghana, we all like democracy, we want to express our views here and there, but there are certain methodologies, there are certain systems and procedures that need to be followed. And so we have a huge, you know, task to work on our democracy if we really want our democracy to get to that stage where we could say that yes, it is now, you know, seeing the light of a real democracy like in US and other countries and all over. So we have a lot to do. But with regards to this power related issue we are talking about, and the sacking of the
ECG,
MD.
Is he sacked or he's been reassigned?
You see, I mean, no matter the situation or how you looked at it, as from last week, he has been reassigned, but it is more like sacking. Mm. Because the man assumed, the position of MD almost less than 3 years ago. Mm. But if you monitor the country round, I don't know if the ministers have been going around watching what this man has been able to do.
Okay.
Within a minute, over 3 years now. I mean, I have been monitoring across the six regions that ECG operate, and it is amazing.
Okay.
I don't know whether the ministers themselves are seeing what that man, Reverend Engineer William
Mensah. Can you tell us exactly what he's done that's amazing?
In Ashanti region, in Ashanti region alone, he has been able to build almost about 10, district offices.
Of ECG?
Yes, of ECG alone in Ashanti region. And before he even assumed power, we learned that the load, or let me use the word, the losses, regards to ECG power supply, the losses alone was around 27.2. But as you speak now, less than 3 years, he has been able to reduce it to 22.8 thereabout.
Is it a roadmap ECG has that happened under his regime, or did that personally?
I mean, I think that the directors and the managers were able to support him. To if you are a leader,
so
you need to bring
exactly
in some.
What exactly went wrong? Why the power crisis under his leadership? Because if he's been reassigned, suggests that something definitely is not right, and we are experiencing the power crisis. So what went wrong? How would you describe the situation we're experiencing?
If you looked at energy situation in this country, ECG is not a generator of power. Mm. ECG, they are into supply distribution of power. It is GRICO and then VRE. They are the producers. They are the generators of power.
So how come it's been left at the doorstep of ECG and they seem to be getting away with if they actually created the problem?
It gives you a certain motive and a certain agenda. Mm. The information out there that everybody is speculating about is that government want to dispose of or give ECG to the private sector.
Mm.
Which, should government dare to do that, then They should know, obviously, that they are going to lose the election.
No, but see, let's also look at it this way.
Before you ask that question, the reality is that during 2007, 2008, thereabout, MPP administration disposed, Vodafone, and NDC criticized them heavily. Mm. That why do you have to, dispose of a strategic asset like Vodafone?
Okay,
and here
less than
5 years or 6 years down the line, you want to dispose of the most strategic assets of the country. Which
so
is
do you think government is sabotaging the works of ECG just to make it easier for them to give it to the private sector?
It is obvious. Looking at the perspective.
How is government doing that?
You see, I mean, nobody could understand why government is doing that.
Did Hutton Mensah stand for government or against government?
No, his agenda is that Ghanaians can do it better.
So what happened? What went wrong? How did government play a role that he couldn't sustain power and we're experiencing all that? Because for me, currently, whatever we have in with ECG is affecting the economy, Ghana at large, and not just political or partisan level.
My lady, why are we not blaming the producer, the generators of the power,
but exactly rather criticizing ECG? You, why are we not blaming VRA and GRIDCO?
It tells you the mindset that they are just preparing the minds of Ghanaians that ECG is not performing, so let's give it to a private sector.
Why couldn't ECG do that communication that it's not our problem that we cannot give you power, but GRIDCO and VRA are not able to give us that power?
I don't know. I mean, last week, you heard the PRO of ECG, Gideon Boateng. Mm-hmm. He was just going round, trying to explain. And information, coming from the big sources are that the minister told him that he shouldn't go around to explain because he's exposing the government. Those are the facts going around. Instead of government to take proper measures to ensure that ECG are able to, distribute power, here is the case. They are trying to hang ECG somewhere and sell it to the private sector, just like former government also did to Vodafone.
At the end of the day, are you saying that Hutton Mensah was trying to cover up for government and he's been betrayed?
No, he's not doing a cover-up. Mm. What he wants to do, or what he has been doing, is that PURC has set a certain, you know, margin for them that the losses, they should be able to reduce the losses.
Was that a non-feasible margin set by the
PURC? No, it is not. It's 21%, okay. Which as we speak now, they have been able to reduce the losses from 27.2 to 22.8. And he is building a lot of infrastructure across the country, around almost, you know, ECG, they operate in 6 regions. They operate in Volta region, Greater Accra, Western, Central, Eastern, and Ashanti region. And he is doing so many things that myself, it beat my imagination that, yes, this is a very strategic person. He means business. He wants to do something to achieve a certain name. And so around the country, ECG, you know, in Kumasi, for instance, this morning, Kumasi, almost about a week ago, Kumasi was only having 50 megawatts of power.
But
as you speak now, this morning alone, Kumasi has received 170 megawatts. What has necessitated this, you know, knee-jerk reaction of giving them excess of power? It tells you the mindset.
Michelle, that's a very good deed, good thought he's, you know, carrying out. But a good deed in words and thoughts is not equal to a good deed felt practically. Now, the situation here is that we did not feel the practical implementation of his good thoughts.
That is the problem now. Reality is that, as you speak now, joy news is all over. Me, I'm a village boy from near the Biasi area. Go there. Everybody is watching joy news in the villages. Go there. You walk to every district office of UCG and you see what the man has been able to achieve within a short period of 3 years.
All these people, so it doesn't mean that government does not stand for the interest of Ghanaians and the economy. That is why this man is doing so much to save the economy and the country, and government will just reassign him.
You see, it's sad. It's sad. Look at the status of Vodafone now. As at 2007-2008, that President Kufuor's administration was packaging ECG, they were just trying to paint Vodafone black then, just to sell it. And now the NDC government is also doing the same thing, trying to paint ECG black so that they could hunker it and sell it to the private sector, which will be quite detrimental to the success of this country. Because, President, what are you ruling now? You do not have control over telecommunication industry. You do not have control over, you know, power, electricity power, and other things. So if somebody wants to do anything in this country, you are empty, you are naked. They could hijack the country.
That should be
the thinking of government, that you shouldn't be able to hand over ECG to a private sector. It is not a good decision at all. And I don't know whoever is advising the president to make these basic mistakes.
All right, so the moment government does not have control over telecommunication, does not have control over power supply and all, it borders on security. And so you would also recall that we've had incidents of residents bargaining to the offices of ECG to destroy some property. It really is putting our security at large, and it's worrying. I have online programs director at the West Africa Network for Peace Building, WANEP, Chukwuemeka Eze, and he's going to help us through with some security issues that we are likely to experience if we do not really sit up. Good morning, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning.
I think I'd want to confess, I would appreciate it if you can help me through with your name.
The name is Chukwuemeka Eze.
Chukwuemeka Eze, thank you so much. We have had some demonstration here in Accra and in Kumasi over ongoing load shedding. What security implication does this pose for Ghana?
Well, I think first of all is to appreciate the fact that there is this space for people to vent their frustrations and anger when it comes to issues relating to nation building. I think that should be encouraged, because that is part of the dividend that is given by democracy. In some parts of the world, it is difficult to even allow citizens to vent their anger. Having said that, I think it is also important that within the space of this kind of engagement, that the aspirations and the expectations of citizens are met as much as is possible by government. And secondly, that where these expectations are facing challenges, that the government communicates better in terms of the choice of language and the mode of communication, so that people are equipped with the knowledge of what is happening within the society. That way, you are not just managing the situation, but you're also managing the expectations of people that sometimes may not be in tandem with the realities on the ground.
The demonstration, they are mainly spontaneous, and police have to mobilize later on. And what should be the posture of the security services in these times particularly?
I think, first of all, the security operatives should appreciate the fact that these demonstrations are legitimate, and some of the concerns are also legitimate concerns. But they should also bear in mind that in such a situation, people also cash in on that and also foment unintended trouble, including even looting in some instances. So while the security operatives give the space, they should also give that within the confines of the law and also manage the situation in such a way that people do not go outside of the intentions, which is to convey people's frustration about what is happening in society.
Let me take you back to your country, Nigeria. I'm sure we have some similarities, particularly in this case, energy crisis and all. Quickly tell us, how did Nigeria, have Nigeria gotten over it, and how were they able to successfully?
Well, Nigeria has not gotten over it, not by any definition. And I think what is happening in Ghana is expected. The society is growing, the country is growing, because of the credentials that Ghana is beginning to record in terms of its stability. There is the tendency for influx of population. And when the expansion in this type of situation is not planned, then you expect that these kind of issues arise. But what countries, developed countries in the world, does is that they make projections about what kind of population explosion would they expect in the next 5 years. Based on that, they begin to develop or re-adapt in terms of their infrastructures. So this is expected of Ghana at this particular time, but I think it is more critical that they continue to engage the Nigerian government based on the gap they are supposed to be getting from Nigeria, to constantly engage the Nigerian government, and begin to also tap other energy sources, including solar, and exploit that. That way they can manage the population explosion that Ghana is experiencing at the moment.
Let me also find out, could you also agree that we have some officials who could be working towards ensuring there is not power stability, because they are able to, through these times, get the importation of generators to, you know, supply power. So that's where they also make their business. Let's look at it both in Ghana and Nigeria.
Well, why that could be a perception and maybe not well established, it is not far from what is happening in Nigeria. Sabotage like this occur because business people cash in on this and then sell and even begin to develop generator plans in the country. So that should be expected, but that should also be monitored to ensure that sabotage is not part of what is happening to the energy situation in Ghana. But whether that is some of the speculations in Nigeria, and that could also happen in Ghana, it is very correct.
All right. I think we'd like to leave it here for now. Thank you so much to Chukwuemeka Eze. He is the program's director at the West Africa Network for ONEP. Thank you so much. We come back to studio. I still have with me David Agbe, the executive director for the Ghana Institute of Governance and Security. And we're still talking a bit about energy crisis and its security. David, let's also look at it from this way. Do you think, coming from the governance and security think tank, what are the security implications for Ghana in terms of the what we now call Dumso Dumso?
Very well. Very well. Before then, Nigeria's situation, you cannot even compare it to Ghana. I was in Nigeria quite recently, almost about 3 months ago. Over there, it's just like somebody is just doing this, like this. It's worse situation.
It's a flash situation.
Yes, they call it NEPA. As soon as it's worse situation. Yeah. So Ghana, we should be at least a bit proud of what we have.
Think about it this way. They all have, now they have some form of power generators. So why would they be going to Ghana and Nigeria? Why would this? I don't know how long we have to contend with this.
You see, let's zero down to Ghana situation. Nigeria, I mean, let's do away with Nigeria for now because of certain, you know, reasons. Our situation now, government should be able to reason very well. I mean, looked at all the demonstrations going on around the country. It's telling you that the mood of the country is not good, security-wise. Mm. The mood of the country is not good. And as we speak now, every Ghanaian is exposed to the international community.
Sure.
You know, when these incident of Tunisia, you know, in 2010, it's replicated in U.S. Wall Street, they call it Occupy the Wall Street. Then 2011, 2012, it came to Nigeria. Nigeria, 2012, when Goodluck Jonathan said that he's going to scrap the fuel subsidy, they call it Occupy Nigeria. And now Ghanaians are also learning, quite recently, Burkina Faso looked at what happened there.
Yeah.
People's power. Mm. They were able to, you know, chase the president, and now he has run away from his country. Everybody is watching what is happening in the global, you know, world now. So government should be able to know, they should be able to advise him that the mood of the country is not good. And as a social democratic government, you want to dispose of a strategic asset of the country, ECG. For what reason? So what is the purpose of you ruling? Why was it that MPP was criticized then when they were selling Vodafone? Mm. Can any of the NDC people have that moral courage and tell Ghanaians and be able to convince Ghanaians if they should dispose of ECG, then they are doomed forever? Because some of us, we've never demonstrated before, right from school days to date. But if government dares to sell ECG...
You've been good boys today.
Yes, I'm a good boy, actually. We are planning around the country, around, you know, the CIS region, to be able to mobilize people from all the regions to come and storm at parliament or at the seat of government.
Is that a threat?
You see, it is not a threat, but we need to demonstrate against government and tell government that the strategic assets of the country cannot be disposed of as we speak now. We shouldn't allow those things to happen in Ghana anymore. We can't continue to sell everything that belongs to Ghana. What are they adding to what Kwame Nkrumah has done? And
but
everything they want to
also,
sell it
off. Don't you also think that we talk government, but we all make part of government, and our own individual attitudes also do not help our growth as a country?
I agree entirely. As you speak now, Mr. Mensah or Engineer Mensah, what has he done? I mean, just take your cameras, go around the country and see the developmental project that this gentleman has done.
I agree. It's a beautiful thing.
And be able to measure it with...
I agree with you if you say he's done so well, he's put up more infrastructures around the country for ECG. But why were we not filling it in our homes through our power supplies?
Very nice question. But the question must be directed to the producers. Greco and VRA, they are the producers and the smaller ones, Asogli and other ones.
I think this business of blaming Greco and VRA, but you see,
if you don't invite me, do you think that I'll come and sit here?
Of course not.
Yes, I won't come and sit here.
You see, I personally have encountered VRA, ECG, and Greco all together.
Yes.
And even in their midst, they pass the blame around. So we never could settle on one of them to admit that we are the creator of the problem. So you see, this blame game thing
Propaganda. To be honest with you, it's a propaganda. In Kumasi, the whole Kumasi used to have 50 megawatts of power almost about 2 weeks ago. This morning alone, ECG has excess of power, 170 megawatts of power. What brought all these kind of changes? Kumasi, if you have 50 megawatts of power, Otunfor's Palace, around Otunfor's Palace, Komfanochi, Barikese Dam, those places, they don't shut power out.
Okay.
When you shut it down, then there will be a crisis. So when you give almost about 12.5 to all those, you know, strategic institutions that I talked about, it's left with 38. The whole of the 38%, they have to distribute it in Ashanti region. So it tells you that those people cannot work without excess of power. In Greater Accra, you go around. Why were people, you know, beating
so
at...
why did ECG, in the middle of all of these, keep quiet?
You know,
why is ECG willing to absorb the problem they cannot resolve?
You see, government is a very powerful institution. I was just telling you that somebody somewhere told the PRO that you shouldn't go on air and be explaining because he's exposing government.
And what did Mr. Mensah do about that?
That one, what can you do? What can you do? Government is not, I mean, telling us the truth. They want to package ECG nicely and sell it. And every Ghanaian must rise up to this occasion and tell government that we are not going to allow this strategic asset to be sold. We should be passionate about our country, as you speak now. We should do away with NDC, MPP, and tell our leaders that enough is enough. We should be able to learn something that the people's power is very, very important. And so we should be able to hold government that we are not going to allow you to sell ECG to any foreign organization anywhere. Ghanaians can manage it. During elections, you hear them quoting Kwame Nkrumah's book, reading all the philosophies and telling you everything. But as soon as they assume power, they've forgotten of all those things that Kwame Nkrumah was saying.
You sound a bit emotional now.
Yes, I'm annoyed, to be honest with you. I hate state institutions to be sold to a private sector.
Mm.
I hate those things. It is not good at all. ECG is not making all the losses as government is saying.
Mm.
We should be able to manage ECG properly as you speak. Mm. Should government dare to sell ECG? We are going around the country.
Why would government want
churches,
to sell ECG?
Mosques and every places to tell people that we should rise up against government.
Why would government want to sell ECG?
I mean, it's obvious. They have their personal interests.
I don't know that. Share that with me.
Yes, they have their personal interests. Why do you want to sell estate assets like ECG?
Yes.
I've already told you that as a government, as a president, if you dispose of your power, you dispose of your telecommunication, all the telecommunication company, that government has, you know, even a strategic interest in it, how much? Those people can tell you that government, we are going to cut all your lines, we are going to listen to every conversations, and now your power, ECG, you want to sell it again. So what do you have to manage?
No, but you still haven't answered my question. Why would government want to sell ECG, a state asset? There should be a good reason there.
What are the reasons?
No, you tell me.
I mean, I don't see any tangible reason that any government official could use to convince Ghanaians.
Mm.
I mean, why was Vodafone sold?
In the case where government says, I am not selling ECG, but give me, you also share your ideas with me how we can all make ECG an effective tool for power supply, what would be your suggestion?
That is exactly what I think ECG is doing now. In Teshi area now, if you go around Teshi now, they are making everything easy for people. In terms of, you know, their meters around, you go to Achimota area, there they are bringing what they call VVIP. You just call ECG office and quickly they'll rush in there to install your meters and all those things for you. I mean, all these initiatives are being, you know, done by that man. Gone are the days. You looked at ECG infrastructure across the country.
Is Engineer William Hutton Mensah a very personal friend to you?
In fact, I am not being driven by those personal friends or whatever it is. I am interested in the success of Ghana.
Mm.
And I do not want a state asset like ECG to be sold or to be given to a private sector. It doesn't make any, you know, reasonable sense, security-wise, everything. Why do you want people to hold you like that? That you cannot control yourself. You do not have access to your telecommunication, you know, infrastructure, and then your power too. So should anything happens, and then those foreigners tells you that no, we are taking off the power. What can you do?
Those are the things
that government officials need to be reasoning
and
be thinking beyond what David Agbe would think. Because I do not have any power.
Right.
They should be thinking of strategic
government.
Ways.
Definitely.
So that people should not come and take Ghana for a ride.
For a ride, yes. So David is getting a bit more emotional here. He doesn't want Ghana to be taken for a ride by any fellow from the international community. And so government, he says, you need to, you know, grab your power and be in control. We have been interacting with David Agbe. He is the executive director of the Ghana Institute of Governance and Security. And he has been quite passionate this morning about our power supply crisis as the security implications and all. And we hope that this conversation gets somewhere and we all get a stable power supply in Ghana and not go through the dumso consistently. We're still with us here on News Desk. When we come back, we are taking a close look at our homes and how we manage them as a family. Stay with us.